So we are very happy to have Professor Sebastian Charnos give the second talk on the very interesting topic of the isotope fascination of the moon, and he will tell us about the basic idea on the perhaps the hydrodynamic escape of a primordial lunar atmosphere might do the trick, and this is a very interesting idea. And Sebastian, please.
Hello, thank you very much. First, I would like to say that I'm very honored to be invited again to give a talk about the question of moon composition, moon formation, and moon devolatilization. So the last time I have presented a kind of overview of a moon formation scenario. And as you have seen, the moon formation scenario is very debated. And today I'm going to, focus more on the question of devolatilization. And I will show you that also there are many uncertainties. Several models are competing. And I do think that modern lunar exploration may help to disentangle the question and may help to better understand the moon formation process. So just I start by some, to remind you some basic facts to put the context. Alors, how do I go to the next slide? Okay. So as you know, the moon is about 1,700 kilometers. It's about 1% of Earth's mass only. And what is very interesting is that it's a very low density. Sorry, there is a mistake here. The Earth density is about 5.5 grams per cubic centimeter, but the moon density is about 3.3 grams per cubic centimeter. So it means that the moon is much lighter than the Earth in terms of density. And it is explained by the very low abundance of iron in the moon. And it has been confirmed by the detection of the iron core by the seismometer on the moon surface, and there is a small iron core. So keep in mind that here the right number is not 3.5, but 5.5 grams per cubic centimeter for the Earth density. Thanks to the Apollo mission and now to the Chinese mission, but for the moment the results are not published, we have on Earth about 400 kilograms of moon material that have been brought back to Earth by space exploration. And the analysis of the moon sample shows that those rocks are in fact called anorthosite. So anorthosite are minerals that typically form at the surface of lava lakes or magma oceans. So those anorthositic minerals, they are very interesting because when you have a lava lake or magma ocean, they form first and they tend to float. They float at the surface of a magma ocean. And then after, they tend to solidify, creating a lid over the magma ocean. So it is expected when you have a global magma ocean that the first thing that you form is an anorthositic crust that covers the magma ocean. And it may take much longer for the magma oceans to solidify. And so, the vast majority of lunar samples brought back to Earth are made of those anorthositic minerals. So it is considered as a strong evidence that there was a magma ocean at some moment at the surface of the moon. Another thing is the composition of moon material. So it's very interesting to compare the abundance of the elementary abundance of elements compared to the Earth mantle. So so here in this graph, it is we have reported the abundance of moon elements compared to the Earth mantle. It is called bulk silicated Earth. And those elements are sorted according to their volatility. So on the left, it is very refractory element. So elements that vaporize at super high temperature. And on the right, it is volatile element. It is volatile elements that vaporize, that goes in vapor at low temperature. And as you see, for the most refractory element, the abundance measured in moon rocks are exactly the same as the Earth's mantle, the bulk silicate Earth. But if you go to more volatile elements, you see that there is a strong depletion of elements. For example, it is moderately volatile element, and here those elements are much more volatile elements. So you see that in fact the moon metal composition is very similar to the Earth mantle, but it is depleted in volatile element. Okay, so I will skip this slide, and now I move to the question of oxygen. Oxygen is a very important isotopic element for a solar system object. As you know, there are three isotopes of oxygen: oxygen 16, 17, and 18. And 16 is by far the most abundant oxygen isotope. In this graph, we have plotted for several elements in the solar system the 17 to 16 ratio divided by the 18 to 16 ratio for different elements in the solar system. So here it is for carbonaceous chondrites, here it is for ordinary chondrites, here it is for other meteorites, okay? And you have to know that the solar wind, oxygen abundance in solar wind in this graph is far on the left, is about minus 60, minus 60, okay? So why oxygen is such an important element? Well, it turns out that all elements that are measured in the solar system has a different isotopic signature in oxygen. You can distinguish between all bodies of the solar system based only on their oxygen isotopic composition. This tells you that the oxygen abundance in the early solar system was very variable. Oxygen isotopic ratio of oxygen was very variable in the early solar system. There are only two objects that we know in the solar system which have exactly the same isotopic signature. It is the Earth and the Moon. Well, on this graph, you see that they are on the same line, and this line is called terrestrial fractionation line, the TFL. And so the very fact that the Earth and the Moon are exactly on the same line tells you that the moon material and the Earth mantle material are derived exactly from the same reservoir. And this happens with absolutely no other object in the solar system. So based on the oxygen isotopic composition, it is we tend to say that the Earth and the moon material, the Earth mantle and the moon material are the same material, in fact, because they have exactly the same oxygen isotopic signature. Now, if we move to other elements, this slide has been given to me by Dr. Paolo Sossi, so I just present it rapidly. So measurement in laboratories basically shows that the isotopic composition of refractory elements in the solar system, refractory elements in the moon, are exactly the same as the Earth. Here you see the isotopic variation of the moon compared to the Earth for very refractory elements. Most refractory elements vaporize at 1600 K and more volatile elements. And basically what you see is that for all those very refractory elements, there is absolutely no difference in isotopic signature. But again, if you go to more volatile elements like zinc, like potassium, or like copper, what you see is that those elements are enriched in heavy isotopes. This is for zinc, this is the Earth, and here you see that zinc in the moon is enriched in heavy isotopes, same for potassium, and same for copper. So the conclusion of that is that, maybe what you see here is maybe the signature or of an evaporation event, because we know that in an out of equilibrium evaporation process, in general, the lightest isotopes go away first. So you are left, the residual is enriched in heavy isotopes. And it seems that this is exactly what we see for the moon material. So all those elements taken together draw a kind of a picture of Ralph Avdija of the moon material. The moon material has many, many similarities with Earth mantle material, especially identical oxygen isotopic signature, but there are still some differences. It is depleted in volatile element first, and those volatile elements are enriched in heavy isotopes. So all that tends to say that maybe the moon material is mostly made of earth mantle material that has been heated to some high temperature, so around 1600 K typically. And this may explain at the same time similarities and difference with the earth material. So now the big question is, how is it possible? How is it possible in the context of our understanding of moon formation? Last time I have presented several models of moon formation, I just remind you that the main idea is that the moon formed after, this little movie is not functioning, I don't understand why, but you have seen it last time. So basically what you see is a giant impact on the Earth. So is it working or not? Okay, this one is working. So in the standard view of moon formation, there is this so-called canonical scenario where it is said that the proto-Earth was impacted by the Mars-sized impactor. And during this impact, the temperature of the material was heated up to 6,000 K on a short time scale. Okay. And here you see that in about 30 hours only, the full Earth is completely molten, and a disk of debris at high temperature, typically here in the range of 4,000 K, typically, has been ejected from the Earth. I remind you that in those SPH simulation of giant impact, we do not see the formation of the moon. Why don't we see the formation of the moon? Because in those SPH impact simulations, there is no radiative transfer. So there is no way to follow the cooling of the system and then the reaccretion of the moon. So if you want to see the formation of the moon, you have to simulate the accretion of the moon from the debris disk that is called the proto-lunar disk. Alors, the story as we see it today is the following. So basically, first you have this lunar giant impact. Then you have the formation of this debris disk that is called the proto-lunar disk. And I'm going to talk about this debris disk. This debris disk is a very complex structure. It is mostly made of vaporized rocks, possibly with a liquid central layer and with over a kind of silicate vapor atmosphere. It's maybe convective, and at the same time, it is spreading and it's radiating its energy away. And we do think that at the edge of this disk, the moon can form. So there have been some attempts to simulate this disk. The first one has been done by Professor Shigeru Ida and its collaborators in the year 2000. Here you see a simulation that is an n-body simulation with a small particles suffering dissipative rebounds. Okay, so it's an n-body simulation. And here you see the simulation seen from above. And what you see is that here you have the Earth that is not displayed. Here you have the debris disk. And what you see in the simulation is that the disk is not continuous. The disk forms very rapidly spiral structures, like in a galaxy. And it means that the disk is gravitationally unstable, like a galaxy, for example. And when a disk is gravitationally unstable, it tends to transport very efficiently material and angular momentum inward and outward. So it means that the disk spread very rapidly. But what you see in the simulation is that as the disk spread, those spiral arms disappear and tends to form some clump here. Look at the clump. If we look at a better, higher resolution simulation, you see that typically those clumps, they form at about 3 Earth radii. And it is not a surprise. We know the concept of Roche limit. The Roche limit around the planet is the region beyond which you can form satellites or aggregates around the planet. If you compare, for example, to the case of the Saturnian system, here is a picture. It's a picture of Cassini. It's not a drawing. Here you have Saturn, you have the rings, and here the F ring here is located precisely at the Roche limit. What you see is that below the Roche limit here, you do not have satellite, you have mostly a ring, a disk. A ring is nothing else like a disk. And beyond the Roche limit, you have no ring anymore, and you have more or less a collection of satellites. So we do think that for the formation of the moon, if we go back to the proto-lunar disk, we do think that below the Roche limit, you have a disk, and beyond the Roche limit, the proto-moon is maybe forming. So this process has been simulated by Kokubo et al. In year 2000. Here you see a simulation, the disk is spreading, and beyond the Roche limit, that is the circle, you see that there is no disk, in fact. Here you see the little proto-moon. So how long does it take? You see in this graph that it takes about 200 orbits to form the proto-moon. So it means that in real-time unit, it means that it is about only 3 weeks. So does it mean that the proto-moon formed in 3 weeks only? Well, we do not think, because here in this simulation, it is only hard sphere simulation. The disk has no internal energy. So we do think that the time scale between the giant impact and the moon formation, in fact, is dominated by the cooling time scale of the disk. The time it takes to the disk to radiate away its internal energy. So now I'm going to look at more in detail the physics of this disk. So this disk, we do think this disk is like that. You have turbulent convection, you have a central magma layer, and so the disk is radiative its energy away. What is the composition of this disk? As I told you in the last presentation, for the canonical model, we have this big question, is that we found that the disk is mostly made of impactor material, okay? So how is it possible? So it puts a big question, as I told you last time. The big question was that how to explain the oxygen isotopic composition of the disk that is completely similar to the Earth, even if it's made of impactor material. Here I recall you that the Earth and Moon are exactly the same oxygen isotopic composition. So to explain the oxygen isotopic composition, so you have a big problem with the canonical scenario, because a priori there is no reason for the oxygen isotopic composition to be the same as the Earth. So it is why you have also this alternative model called the synestia model that invoked an impact on a fast spinning Earth. So this impact is very, very energetic. And in this model designed by Chuck and Stewart in 2012, the idea is that the impact is so energetic that the Earth is spin up, and then it puts most of the material into the proto-lunar disk. In this impact event, the disk is so hot that the disk is almost entirely fully vaporized. And it is why Chuck and Stewart presented the idea of what they call a synestia. It is not really a disk, it's like a big donut, okay, of completely vaporized Earth and impactor material. And the moon will form within this very hot environment. So how to solve the problem of the isotopic composition in this disk? So the first idea is to invoke mixing within the disk. So it has been brought by Palevan and Stevenson in 2009. And the second idea is just to say that the moon is made of Earth mantle material, which is compatible with the synestia model. So in the idea of Palevan and Stevenson, they did a model of the proto-lunar disk, like a protoplanetary disk, with a very high level of diffusivity, okay? So they do not know the source of diffusion in the disk. It could be turbulence, it could be very high molecular diffusion, but they have modelized it using a kind of fudge value of the turbulence parameter. And what they find is that if the turbulence is strong enough, you need about less, a little bit more than 100 years only to completely homogenize the isotopic abundance within the protolunar disk. Okay. So now the big question is it short enough? Is it short enough for the disk to 100 years? It is short enough for the disk to homogenize the system in the sense, can the disk can survive more than the homogenization time? Okay. And the second question is, what is the source of such a high level of diffusivity in the disk? Well, so we have to go now in much a little bit deeper in modelization of this disk to understand that. Parallel to that, you have the problem of devolatilization. We all agree that the disk was very hot, several thousands of Kelvin, but now how to devolatilize the material? So here you have two schools to devolatilize the materials. You have two ways to do that. The first way is through what is called incomplete condensation. What is incomplete condensation? The idea is that you have a very hot vapor, and when you cool down the vapor, the most refractory elements will condensate first. Okay? So you will have a refractory rich condensate phase. This is the first idea. And this idea has been studied by several authors, myself, Robin Canup, Locke and Stewart, etc. And you have a second way of doing the job to devolatilize the early moon is evaporation above magma oceans. And I'm going to briefly present the two ideas. So one thing that is very important to understand is that in different scenarios of moon formation, you have very different level of temperature and then vapor mass fraction. In the standard canonical scenario of Robin Canup, published in 2004, the vapor mass fraction is about 26%. So one quarter of the mass is made of vapor. It means that most of the mass is in solid phase. So it's not super easy to devolatilize in this scenario. But if you take the extreme case of the fast spinning Earth scenario, the one with the donut shaped synestia, you see that the vapor mass fraction goes up to almost 100%. It means that initially, all the system is in vapor form, more or less. Okay? And depending on some details, you have some intermediate scenario where you reach intermediate value of vapor mass fraction. So the scenario of moon formation will not be exactly the same in the case where it is dominated by vapor initially, like in the synestia model, or dominated by liquid, like in the canonical scenario. So what is the physics of this disk? So you have a radiative cooling layer at the top of the protolunar disk. This radiative cooling layer, we think, is about 2000 K. It radiates away energy. In the middle, you have a hot magma layer because the pressure and temperature is high enough for the silicate material to be in liquid form. But this hot magma layer can generate heat because it is viscous. Since it generates heat, it can heat up also the vapor atmosphere above. So the hot magma layer will degas and create a hot vapor atmosphere. And since you have a decreasing temperature with distance, this hot magma atmosphere will condensate back into the hot magma layer on the far edge of the disk. Okay. And so all of this is coupled. So we have tried to modelize this disk to answer several questions. The first question is, what is the cooling time scale? How long it takes for this disk to cool down? So it's important for several questions, isotopic equilibration, homogenization, and time scale of moon formation. The second question is, what is the dynamical evolution of this disk? Does it spread or not? Is the moon forming from this disk? What is the physics of the disk when it's interacting with the proto moon? And the last question I'm going to discuss also is the chemical evolution of this disk. How can you deplete volatiles? You see that the big problem here is that even though the silicate, the condensate material can lose its vapor, If you want to remove volatiles from the system, you have to physically separate the vapor from the liquid, okay? Because if the vapor just stay in contact with the liquid, after some time, when the disk cools down, the vapor will recondensate back to the liquid, and then you will have no volatile depletion and no isotopic fractionation. So we have to find a way in the disk to separate the liquid from the vapor, and it is not an easy thing, and only a dynamical study of this disk can maybe give some insight on this physics. So let's start, for example, from a disk like that. So here is a disk simulated by Robin Canup in 2013, seen from above. And here we assume, for example, so this is the surface density of the disk as a function of distance to the Earth in unit of Earth radius. And we assume that about 20% of the mass is made of vapor and 80% of the mass is made in liquid, in black. So in a work that I've published with Chloé Michaud in 2015, we have done a 1D model where we treat separately the liquid layer and the vapor layer. Okay, and the idea is that the vapor viscosity is completely different from the liquid viscosity. So first, if you assume that the vapor is just made of molecules, the molecular viscosity is very low. It's almost inviscid. But the liquid here in the dense layer can be very viscous, in fact. First, because the liquid is in general more viscous than the gas. But the strongest argument is that the liquid can become gravitationally unstable. If you look at a simulation like that, you see that the central layer here makes spiral arms. And when you do spiral arms, it means that your disk is gravitationally unstable. Then there is an enhanced viscosity. So, and this viscosity makes spreading much more rapid first and makes heating much more efficient. So we have simulated this disk. Here you see the surface density. Here you have the vapor. And what you see here, this is the mass flux. So you see that on the outer edge of the disk spreads very efficiently. And on the inner edge of the disk falls very efficiently also on the surface of the moon. So the disk spreads very efficiently radially. And in fact, most of the disk mass falls back to the Earth. And only a small portion of the disk mass goes away. In this graph, you see the disk evolution as a function of time. So this is the distance to the Earth, and this is time. So you see that in the very early phase, the disk is super hot, about 4,000 K. And after about, let's say, 1,000 years, you see that the disk temperature drops below, let's say, 1,000 K. Okay, and then finally, you have some burst phase. I will not go in details, and it becomes completely solid in about 100,000 years. Okay, so we would say that the disk cooling time scale is about 10 to the 3 or 10 to the 4 years. Okay. What about the chemistry? We have simulated the chemistry in this disk, so simulating different elements with different volatile levels. And in fact, we do see that in the very simple disk, there is almost no fractionation, no depletion in volatile elements, simply because at the end, we do see even an enrichment in volatile. Why do we see an enrichment in volatile in the disk? Because most of the liquid has fallen back to the moon's surface. Okay, so it seems that this is not really what we want. We do find a volatile enhancement rather than a volatile depletion. It is because we do not really separate the liquid from the vapor. Interestingly, we have found an interesting solution. The idea was to say that maybe the vapor was super viscous, and a possibility to make a vapor super viscous is to invoke magneto-rotational instability. The idea is to couple the vapor to the magnetic field, exactly like in protoplanetary disk. And this is not a stupid idea because there was maybe a small magnetic field on the proto-Earth first, and second, because of very high temperatures, the vapor could be ionized because of thermal ionization. So we have redone the same model We have redone the same model with a super viscous vapor layer that is with a magnetorotational instability, coupled to a liquid layer that is gravitationally unstable. And what we find in those simulations is that because of the high viscosity of the vapor layer, you have a very strong heating of the disk, and the disk almost fully vaporizes. The disk becomes 80% vaporized almost at 80%. And the disk almost disappears. Most of the disk mass falls onto the Earth. And only what can survive is a little bit of liquid. And when we compute the depletion in volatile element, what we see is that it is strongly depleted in volatile element. So here in this approach that we have proposed, what we suggest is that the vapor was MRE unstable. And then we find a way to maybe remove a volatile element from the disk. And this idea has become quite popular, and some other authors, like Gami and other authors, have studied the possibility for the protoneuron-lunar disk to be MRI unstable, and they found that it was indeed the case. But you have to keep in mind that it is a very crude model for the moment. And in this model, we have a model of a disk, but we do not have really a moon forming in those simple models. So I would say it's the first interesting approach. Then there was another kind of approach that was developed by Robin Canup. Robin Canup proposed the following thing. So the same, you have a liquid and vapor disk, and here you have the moon that is forming at the edge of the protolunar disk, okay? And what proposed Robin Canup is the following. So like in our model, the refractory liquid flows outward and feeds the moon. But what at the same time, the new proto-moon exerts a gravitational torque on the disk and prevents the vapor from reaching the proto-moon. So thanks to the gravitational torque, the vapor cannot reach the proto-moon. Okay. In that case, you have a moon that is rich in refractory element and poor in volatile element. This has been proposed so by Robin Canup, and it's a very interesting approach, but as you see, like in our model, there are a lot of uncertainties on the disk physics. You have a lot of simplification of the disk physics, so it could be also a possibility, but we still do not know. The last approach for the incomplete condensation is a synestia model. So in the synestia model also, we lack a very good description. So it has been mostly described in the Locke et al. 2019 model. So what they do in the Locke et al. Model, so they have this very super hot disk and they modelize it with SPH simulation. They try to find the hydrostatic solution of the disk at different temperatures. And so here you see the very young disk that is super hot, and then a little bit later it's colder, colder, colder. And as the disk cools down, the disk shrinks because the disk is so hot that it is pressure supported. And so here you have to think that it is not a real-time evolution. What Locke et al. Does, they only do steady-state solution at different temperatures. So they simulate a time evolution with a kind of temperature function with time, but all those simulations are all those states, as you see, are steady state. Okay. So there is no real time evolution. What they see in their model is the following. When the vapor cools down, you create droplets. And they think that those droplets, they fall to the mid plane of the protolunar disk. And then they are refractory rich. And what Locke et al. Says is that when the disk cools down, the vapor goes back to the Earth, as you see in this model. The only problem is that they do not properly simulate the moon accretion. So in fact, I would say that it's not very clear if it's really what happened. It's very possible also that some of the vapor goes back to the moon and re-enrich in volatile element. What they show in this graph is that if you assume formation of the moon at different pressure and different temperature, they do find depletion of volatile element as you see here, and same value as the Earth for the most refractory element. Okay. The only problem is that it's always that it is only steady state calculation and there is no real time evolution. So it's also an interesting approach. But the question is that what happens when the disk cool down? They do not really consider the reincorporation of cold vapor into the early moon. So this is another possibility. So you see that within the context of the protolunar disk, in fact, we all invoked incomplete condensation, but the big problem is that we do not know really the physics of this disk, which is a big problem. You have a lot of, simple model, like myself, I'm doing simple models, Robin Canup, Locke and Stewart, we all do simple models, but fundamentally, there are a lot of unknowns on the physics of this disk, and so it is still a problem. But now I will just finish this presentation by showing an alternate possibility on which I have worked very recently, and also my colleague in California, Ed Young and Tang has worked on the same idea. We have tried to investigate a much simpler idea. We were motivated by the fact that we all agree on the fact that it is very probable that the moon was fully molten when it formed first. And also, we know much better the physics of evaporation and magma ocean than the physics of the protolunar disk. So the idea is not to say that the protolunar disk model are bad. The idea is to try to investigate an alternative way with a physics that is much better understood than the very complex physics of the protolunar disk. So starting from the idea that the moon was molten, so we first assume that the moon was made of Earth material first. Second, we assume that the moon, the proto moon, forms at the Earth's Roche limit at about 3 Earth radii. So we have done some simulation here where we just try to compute the fate of material escaping from the moon. I'm going to talk about the escape process. But let's imagine that for some reason, vapor material goes away from the moon. So here you see the proto-Earth, here you see the proto-moon, and all black lines are trajectories of parcels of gas that are escaping the moon through the Lagrange point. What you see here, in fact, is that if you eject material from the moon, it never comes back to the moon. It is always trapped in orbit around the Earth. Why material never comes back to the moon if it is ejected from the moon? Simply because of three-body gravitational interaction. So the first body is the Earth, the second body is the moon, and the third body is the parcel of gas. In the three-body, in the restricted three-body problem, we know that the secondary body is protected by a barrier of potential that is called the Lagrange point. And to go back to the moon surface, it's very difficult because you have to pass exactly through the L1 and L2 Lagrange point. And if you lose just a little bit of energy, for example, through radiation or through friction, for example, it's impossible to go back through the L1 and L2 Lagrange point. So the first message of those simulation is that if material is ejected from the moon, it does not come back. Okay, but it stays in orbit around the Earth. So understanding that, now we have tried to model hydrodynamical escape from a molten protomoon. So the first thing to consider if you want to model hydrodynamical escape is the connection between the magma ocean and the base of the atmosphere. So let's assume that you have a molten surface here that is liquid. And over, just over the surface, you have the vapor. And the vapor is taken from the liquid surface. So evaporation process is described in physics by the classic Hertz-Knudsen theory. So it is in all physics textbooks, okay? And the Hertz-Knudsen theory tells very interesting things. First, if you take a liquid gas, if you take a liquid surface that is degassing, the vapor is extracted from the liquid at the sound speed. It goes it goes upward at the sound speed, but the sound speed taken at the pressure of saturation. It is called a free flux. So the liquid surface lose vapor through the free flux. But also the vapor above the liquid surface has its own pressure that is maybe not exactly the same as the saturating vapor pressure. And in fact, there is a return flux because of molecular diffusion in the vapor, because of Brownian motion in the vapor, some of the vapor molecules will go back to the liquid surface. And you can compute this flux of particles, of molecules going back to the liquid, and it is called the return flux. So the net flux, it is the net flux that is going away from the melt surface. It is the free flux minus the return flux. And it depends on the difference of pressure between the saturating vapor pressure and the pressure in the vapor. But then the Hertz-Knudsen theory tells something very simple but super important. It tells you that when the pressure in the vapor is at equilibrium with the melt, so it means that when the pressure in the vapor is equal to the saturating pressure, both pressures are equal. So it means that there is no evaporation anymore. It just means that the outgoing flux is equal to the return flux. So in total, there is no net flux, first. And second, at chemical equilibrium, since you have a full equilibrium between the liquid and the vapor phase, you have a full mixing of the species, and there is no isotopic fractionation anymore. So in short, it tells you that if evaporation occurs at equilibrium with P pressure equals Psat in the vapor, in fact, you have no evaporation anymore, and you have no isotopic fractionation anymore. So it is a big problem for evaporation. So the big question, if we want to devolatilize the moon and have isotopic fractionation, you have to find a way to break this equilibrium. So we have done a study of the interaction between the melt with the vapor pressure, and we think maybe we have found a very simple way to break this chemical equilibration between the liquid and the liquid and the gas. Simply, when you have hydrodynamical escape, vapor is not static. Vapor is moving upward. So the vapor has a vertical velocity. And when you compute the Brownian motion of particles in a vapor that is traveling upward with an advective velocity equals to Va, what you find, in fact, is that the return flux to the liquid surface is much smaller than for a static vapor. So the simple fact that the vapor is moving upward breaks the equilibrium. The return flux is smaller also, and you can have a net outgoing flux that is positive. You can have an outgoing flux. So what is the origin of that? It is very simple. Here, what you look at, it is a Maxwellian velocity distribution of molecule in a static vapor. So this velocity distribution is centered on zero. And if the vapor is static, all particles with a negative velocity go back to the surface. So the return flux, it is the area below the Maxwellian. But now if the vapor is moving, the velocity distribution is not anymore centered on zero. It is centered on some positive value. So only particles with a negative velocity can go back to the surface. And you see that the area below the Maxwellian here is much smaller than in the static case. So just doing this little computation of kinetic of molecules, we could compute the pressure at the surface of the liquid as a function of the velocity of the atmosphere just above the liquid. And the pressure at the surface of the liquid drops with velocity, and it depends on the ratio of the advective velocity to the thermal velocity. And what we find is interesting: to reproduce isotopic fractionation of that is observed in a moon sample, you need an advection velocity that is about only 1% of the sound velocity. And you will see that it is about what we find solution in the good range. So now, what is the physics of hydrodynamical escape? So let's imagine you have a very hot layer. The gas is very hot, okay? So you have a very strong pressure gradient, and the gas wants to move upward. Simply, it blows off in space. So the physics of hydrodynamical escape has been described by Parker in the 60s and 70s. It was initially for the sun. And so the physics is quite complex, but the equations are quite simple. So you solve for the flux conservation, okay? You solve for the momentum conservation, and also we assume adiabatic expansion of the gas. Alors, it is what we call exactly wet adiabatic. It means that the gas suffers adiabatic transformation, but at the same time, the gas condenses into droplets. But still, you can compute the adiabatic transformation taking into account the latent heat of condensation. And so you have a kind of adiabatic mixing of gas plus droplets. Okay. So we have computed all that. And what we found of the moon is the following. So here you have the distance to the moon, and here you have the velocity of the gas above the surface. So this is the distance to the moon in unit in moon radii. If you take, for example, the yellow curve, so it is for moon surface at 2000 K, what you see here is that temperature drops with expansion, okay? So the temperature drops rapidly, so we find a lot of recondensation of the gas as it's going the way. And here you see the velocity. And the velocity, it's very interesting because the velocity is increasing with altitude. It is a classic hydrodynamical escape solution. In those hydrodynamical escape solutions, the velocity gets very high, and because of mass conservation, the pressure drops with altitude. And at some point, the velocity becomes equal to the local sound velocity. It is the red dot here. It is called the transonic point. So you go at the sound velocity, but there is no shock wave. And when the gas crosses the green line here, then the gas is lost from the moon and is put in orbit around the Earth. And so you see that for a gas at 2000 K, the velocity at the surface is about 200 meters per second. So it's too high for isotopic fractionation. But when the gas is at 1600 K, you get a velocity that is about less than 100 meters per second. And it is about in the range of what you need for good isotropic fractionation. So we have computed the fluxes. And the fluxes, so this is the Earth-Moon distance because it depends on the distance of the Earth-Moon distance. Here you have the flux computed in moon mass per year. And the different colors correspond to different temperatures of the moon. So what you see first is that as the moon goes away, the flux drops. Why the flux drops is simply because the Earth tides are increasingly inefficient to drag material from the moon. So when the moon is very close, it is very easy to escape because of Earth tides. But when the moon goes away, it becomes increasingly difficult for the gas to go away. So the flux drops. So now the question is, what is a good range of temperature to explain the moon composition? So we have focused on the case of sodium, potassium, and zinc. So here, this is the sodium, potassium, and zinc measurement in a lunar sample. This is the blue box. And the different lines that you see, it is different scenarios, so different temperatures, different fractionation levels, etc. And our conclusion is the following. We have many solutions to explain at the same time the abundance of sodium and potassium in moon sample. It seems that you can lose most of the sodium and potassium with a proto moon at about 1,600 or 1,800 K. But in all cases, we have a problem with zinc. We never match properly the zinc abundance at the same time. Each time, we always find a very low abundance of zinc compared to measurement. In short, there is too much zinc in lunar samples compared to our model. So it seems that we have a good match for potassium and sodium, but not a good match for zinc. It seems that something has preserved zinc in the moon material. And the possibility is that zinc forms a complex mineral, maybe that sink into the magma ocean, so maybe it's protected from evaporation. So it's a possibility that has been suggested by my colleague Paolo Sossi, that you will see, and Frédéric Monnier. But for the moment, it needs to be investigated. But we do think it's still encouraging that we find a good match for the abundance of sodium and potassium. So concerning the isotopic composition, the range of thermal velocity divided by surface velocity divided by thermal velocity must be in the range of about 10 to the minus 2. And it corresponds to moons at about typically 1,700 K between distance 3.5 to 4.5 Earth-Moon radial. And it is interesting because it falls more or less between the range of temperature and distance that we expect for early moon. So I will skip this slide. So to finish, now we have seen that there is a range of complex models to explain the moon devolatilization. There is no agreement for the moment. You have people who want to devolatile the moon inside the protolunar disk through incomplete condensation. And you have other models that they suggest that the devolatilization happen after the moon formation during the magma ocean phase. And for the moment, there is no consensus on that, and it is still an open question. In the current context where there are many missions that are programmed to go to the moon and bring back samples to the Earth, I have tried to put in this slide some of the outstanding questions that would be important to do some progress on those questions. The big question, in fact, is about the homogeneity of our samples. Because we say that the moon is devolatilized, we say that the moon shows isotopic fractionation of volatile elements. But is it true everywhere on the moon's surface? We have no good idea about that. Are all terrains on the moon, do they show the same devolatilization? And what about the far side? Does the far side show exactly the same devolatilization? For example, for the case of the magma ocean at the surface, there should be strong difference between the far side and the near side, particularly because the far side should be colder than the near side. So the far side should capture much more volatile elements than the far side, than the near side. The far side should be much more volatile rich than the near side. And we really would like to know that. Okay, so this would be measuring moon sample coming from the far side would be an outstanding information to make better progress on the question of moon formation. Is there zinc or copper hidden below the surface? We do not match the abundance of zinc, but what about in the interior of the moon or just below the surface? Because this question of devolatilization, it is just a surface effect, or it is exactly the same in the interior? For the moment, we do not know. A last question that moon mission may answer is the question of the initial amount of oxygen on the moon. Because in all the simulation I have shown you, we have assumed that the moon was made of Earth material that do not have a lot of oxygen and hydrogen. Okay. And so if there was an abundant source of oxygen and hydrogen, it would completely change the thermodynamics of the evaporation and the thermodynamics of the protolunar disk. And for the moment, we do not really know. We used to think that the moon was very dry, but there are some new measurements from apatite minerals that has been measured in the last year that tend to say that maybe there was more oxygen than we saw. So in conclusion, understanding the moon formation needs a multidisciplinary approach. We have some embryo of scenario. They all pass through this complex phase of the protolunar disk. But there are still big questions about the angular momentum and the moon initial material. And to explain the devolatilization in the moon, we have scenarios in the protolunar disk, scenarios in the magma ocean that do not happen at the same time. And only further exploration of the moon may help us to answer those questions. I have finished and I thank you very much.
Yeah, Sebastian, thank you so much. It was a wonderful talk, and you cover almost everything. One quick thing off.
It was a little bit long, I'm sorry about that.
Oh, that's fine, that's great. You know, you are gonna talk again, right?
With pleasure. If you invite me, I can talk more.
Okay, we will do it. We'll do that. But yeah. Now I have a couple of questions, you know.
Yeah, with pleasure.
Because you at the end, you said talk about this, the possible far side, near side asymmetry.
Yeah.
But that depends very much on there's no circulation, no atmospheric exchange, you know, between the near side and far side, right?
Yeah, it's true. Alors, in the models that I've shown you, you have understood that all models are very simple, okay? Mm. It is 1D model, okay? Recently, there was a paper by Saxena. Saxena, I think it's 2000, let me check. Okay, there was a paper in 2017 by Saxena et al. That tried to study the circulation of atmosphere on young and molten protomoon. And what they find is very interesting. They find that the near side is illuminated by the hot Earth. So the near side is much hotter than the far side. So they found that you have very strong circulation of winds on this molten protomoon with a supersonic wind starting from the near side and going to the far side. And at the far side, the material is put at colder temperature and the material recondenses on the far side because it is colder. And you have the same process is invoked for a super short period exoplanets. Okay. And so the suggestion of Saxena is that you may have a difference between the chemistry on the far side and near side. So if devolatilization happened when the moon was fully formed and covered by a magma ocean, this process can take effect. On the other hand, if the moon formed by incomplete condensation in the protolunar disk, and if devolatilization happened inside the protolunar disk, we think that this process may be not so effective because it would mean that the devolatilization happened is a bulk process. So maybe measuring what's going on the far side would help to make the difference between models that form the moon in a protolunar disk or devolatilize the moon later.
Right. Okay. That's the, and also that, you know, that what you just described is a hydrodynamic wind from the lunar surface.
Exactly.
And you just also said that the similar thing might have happened on the lunar disk, and the disk wind situation. Yeah.
So for the case of hydrodynamical escape of the protomoon, the wind starts from the protomoon and goes away, but the wind is trapped around the Earth, but do not come back to the moon. For the case of hydrodynamical escape from the disk itself, it has been studied by Nakajima and Stevenson, and it has been studied by people from LC, from Tokyo Tech, okay? And what they found is that it's very hard to have hydrodynamical escape from the disk itself because the Earth's gravitational field is very strong and do not allow the wind to go away from the Earth. Nothing can escape the Earth. Mm-hmm. And the main argument is that there is not enough hydrogen in the system because the Earth is hydrogen poor. So you only have heavy atoms, oxygen, silicium, magnesium, that are very, very heavy atoms. And they are too strong to go away from the disk. So in short, it's very difficult to have hydrodynamical wind from the disk itself, but it's much easier to have hydrodynamical wind from the moon itself.
Mm-hmm. But then the other point, the last point you mentioned about it actually is about the finding of there could be a lot of water, you know, in the mantle. How does that fit into the magma ocean in a picture?
If there was more water than we thought, then it can change the whole picture. Mm. Because water is super volatile. Hydrogen is very volatile. And if you put a little bit of water in all the system, okay, you can have much stronger wind, much stronger evaporation, much higher pressure. And so it needs to be studied. And for the moment, there is no paper that puts water in those thermodynamical models, simply because the chemistry is not easy to compute. But it is clearly something that must be investigated. Reduce this model with more water, and also because we lack thermodynamic data. And so it needs also experiments. What's going on with the mixture of silicates and water at 4,000 K? We must do experiments to better understand the chemistry and the thermodynamics of that.
Okay, thank you so much, Sebastian. I understand that you have a full day of a few days of vacation with your family, and have a good time and happy New Year, because we are going to have a Lunar New Year in a few days also.
Ah, okay. So in Paris there will be some small celebration because of COVID, and I think we will attend them in Paris also.
Okay, I will write to you, to arrange your number three talk. Okay.
Thank you so much. With pleasure.
Okay, good. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.